good point with 14SX and all the Monomials. Monomials of the Greek League. Then we had that h of phi d of x is just d h of x. And the other relation, if I have the Segrin map, well, I should write mn, but never mind.
Something
thing that counts. The zeros of f are counted positively, and the fours are counted negatively. Now, this function is a bit complicated to define. It's not obvious. And actually, Weyl did it only, he assumed the variety was smooth. It's not necessary, you have to give the following definition. Let's say if x is smooth along y, that means, that doesn't mean that the singular locus doesn't mean y, but it's the y is not contained in the singular locus. Y is not contained in the singular locus. Of course, that's something a bit exceptional, but if you think of a singular curve, then it can happen. It can happen, I mean, that y is contained in the singular locus. So in that case, if you look at the local ring, this is actually a discrete, so these are the functions that are regular in the neighborhood of y. So actually it's a discrete valuation ring. So in that case there is an obvious definition of the odd. You can look, in that case you can define the order y of f would be the maximum of n such that, well, let's say if the function is regular at y, the maximum of n such that f belongs to the maximal ideal to the power of n. So that works well if x is smooth. If x is a curve, you can also define this order with dimensions. But in general, so if in general, you should be aware that you have only an inequality like this. I mean, this still makes sense, but it doesn't define the proper y. The correct definition was actually given by Fulton, and it is in his book on intersection theory. It's explained very clearly. What you should do is you define the order of the function would be the length. Of the quotient, so you write 4xy, you take the quotient by the ideal generated by f, and this is the length over this local ring. So this is the correct definition of the order. And of course, so that defines it over x, y, and after to define it over any function, you define it as a quotient of two elements, and then it's the difference of the two. So that defines the divisor of a function, and then so you define, of course, the principal divisors are just functions. And then you define the class group to be the group of divisors, almost by construction, of course, it's a group, and you mark out by px. It is true, but not obvious, that the class group is this functorial. That is, if you have a map between two variety arbitrary z, a morphism phi, between class groups. I will explain why it is not entirely obvious. There is an apparently easy way on the level of devices. If you have, if I have a device of D, well, I will take Y and irreducible hypersurface on Z. The first idea would be to take F minus one of Y. Well, there's two problems in doing that. So the first, which is not too problem one, is to take multiplicities, and so that can be solved easily. And you have to take multiplicities in order to to make sense. I mean, if you take the map to X, this is Xn. Well, obviously, phi minus 1 of 0 should be n times the point 0, and certainly not just 0. That can be solved. The other problem is, what if the whole image of X is contained in Y? What do you do? And I insist it's impossible to define properly the inverse image of the divisor in that case. It doesn't make sense. So why did you have Fontorial scale Fontorial map? Is you need to show some kind of moving lemma. That is, you can there exist I've changed here, should call all of them with the same letter, it will be clearer. Here, maybe there exists a function such that, if I add the problem disappears. So I can add the divisor of a function so that actually the image of X is not contained anymore in any of the components of the new divisor that I obtained. But you notice that this is very plausible, but it's not at all obvious, and it's actually hard to prove. Nevertheless, it is true. Okay, you can define and you can define it that way. I should also say that one obvious thing is that the the divisor of the function is the divisor of F composed with phi. That's depending on the definition, but I guess that's relatively easy. The moving lemma is much harder, even if it's true. So, very divisor are sort of very natural, but they are a bit complicated. There is an easier notion, actually, even if it was discovered later, which is due to Cartier. The idea is, instead of looking at hypersurfaces, you look at equations for hypersurfaces. In some sense, the idea is, what is a hypersurface? It's something that locally is defined by one equation. That's the definition of cartridge divider. So concretely, what you do is, you can write a more functorial definition, but you write it with a collection of open subsets and functions on the open subsets, which satisfies the following thing. Well, first, the union, the UI, is equal to the cover. It's a covering. So the function fi is a function on the open subset. Well, if you want, there are functions on the variety. It's the same. And they match the defined the same divisor in some sense, on the intersection, which means that okay, if I take the quotient, this is a unit in the where it's defined. It's a unit as long as zeros and no poles. The idea, instead of looking at the hypersurface, I cover the hypersurface by patches, open subsets, and I take one equation for the hypersurface. So that you call a Cartier divisor gives us, well, an obvious equivalence relation that I don't write, and what is less obvious is that you can add two of these divisors. Well, you just have by say bi, no, bj, bj. Then you will write the sum of the two. Well, you can define over ui intersected with bj. You can take the product of I, okay. That will be the covering and the new function. It's clear that okay, this equation defines the hypersurface of this one plus this one. there is, and you define the principle, okay, the divisor is just. Well, if you take one, you can just take one patch. And now you notice that okay, one of the reasons why Cartier divisors are simpler is that the moving lemma is absolutely obvious. To take a moving lemma, well, you write, let's say, the divisor D. I will write D minus the divisor, say, of Fi, one of them. Then I get a new collection, say, J, where you write function Fj, Fi minus one. So this divisor has no pole no pole. No zeros or four on UI. So the moving lemma is obvious for is a triviality for Cartier divisors. And that's actually one of the main reasons why there are simpler technically.
Is Fi one of the maps in the definition of D prime? Fi, is it one of those?
No. That is maybe.
Or is it just an intuition?
I should perhaps correct. Well, the formula would be any. I could put anything here. But I choose exactly, no, I choose one of them. So that for this I get the function 1. So now I have a fracture divisor with no zero or four on this open subset UI.
Could you please define it
as
D prime?
I call it D prime. So it's just, I think, a way that this divisor. So if I use this formula, it's just the covering is the same, but the function, this function fj, they get all multiplied by fi to the minus 1. Oh, it's a very simple trick. But so it shows a moving lemma, that is, I can replace any divisor by a linearly equivalent divisor, which has no zeros and four wherever I want. Okay. what else? Perhaps to compare, you have a map from, if I call, if I call Cartier divisor CA, I will drop this notation later. There's a map from Duvel divisors. If I take my D with those notation, for any y, well, y will meet some of the UI. It's a hypersurface. It meets at least one. Then I define the order at y of the divisor D to be the order at y of the function fi. It's a definition. Choose this very divisor. One thing that you have to check is that it doesn't depend on the open subset that you choose, but that's quite easy to show. So you have a map. It's also easy to see that it induces a map from. So I will call the group of classes of Cartier divisor, I will call the Picard group. So that's slightly abusive, because usually the Picard group is a group of line bundles. But really, for any variety, for varieties, that there are isomorphic always, so it's not a big an abuse. I have a map like this, which is natural. Now, this is not always an isomorphism. What are the natural conditions? Fx is normal, then this map is injective. So that's not a too strict condition, but of course it can be false. If x is so-called locally factorial, so meaning all the local rings are factorial, then this is an isomorphism. So, in particular, if x is smooth, then these two are isomorphic. But you can construct examples where it's not injective or not surjective, it's not that hard. Of course, you have to take singular brackets, but. And so, in which sense, perhaps I should give at least the example, and at least an obvious example that state that, well, this is Z. someone is big, it's an algebraic variety. It's actually an abelian variety of dimension, the genus, that we'll see later. But in the case of the negative curve, this is isomorphic to E. So it has lots of points, it's a huge kernel, but lots of line bundles that have degree zero, which are not trivial. That's just to get a feeling of what peak is. Now, there's a nice, not bijection, but description of one with the other, of maps from varieties to PN and so-called linear systems. So I want to recall that. Well, if I have, not necessarily an embedding, but just a map to PN, I can define a system of so I will assume that it's non-degenerate, which means that the image is not included in a hyperplane. It's quite natural. I mean, if the image is contained in a hyperplane, I can take a smaller PN and I can do that until this condition is satisfied. So it's not a nasty condition. Then, in that case, for any hyperplane, well, the pullback of H is well defined. It's well defined. It's a divisor on X. And in that point, it doesn't matter too much what kind of divisor I look at. In that case, it's even a Cartier divisor. So if I look at this family, I said that they are all linearly equivalent. This is a remark, is that phi star of H minus phi star say of H2 is the divisor of a function. It's just for f equal, well, if I call L, maybe it's better if I call L1 an equation for the first hyperplane and L2 an equation for the second hyperplane, if I take this function, this equation is true. That's what we see to see. So you get a whole bunch of linearly equivalent divisors. And
what is L1?
Oh, equation, let's say, I write H1, it's a set of X in the N, that's L1 of X equals 0. So, it's not a function on PN, but it's a homogeneous equation, so when I take the quotient of the two, I do get a function. So from a map, you get like this a family of devices all linearly equivalent, and if you look at this, I mean, if I take I will call if D is a divisor on X, I will call the linear system associated to D, that will be the set of divisors that are positive. Sorry, I forgot to define positivity, but it's an obvious notion. Positivity for pair divisors, just all the coefficients. functions are positive, and for Cartier divisor you ask that the function fi are actually regular on U1, such that the prime is linearly. This is called the linear series or linearly linear system. As a set, it's naturally some projective space. So, if you look at the set of, for example, if you look at the set of one star, the set of I star of H, for H, I plan. Well, this is a subset of the linear system, say, of one of them. I say a subset because you don't get, there's no reason why you should get all of them. Actually, you say that you get all of them, that's a definition of projective normality. And if you've seen and studied that, you know that it's not true that any embedding is projectively normal. But what is true is that this is some Pn inside this Pn. That's quite easy to see because probably get essentially synthetic defined by linearly. So this picture is to explain that any map from X to Pn that corresponds a linear subspace in this linear series. And you can actually work backwards. So now I will consider the following. So from maps, I have associated, in some sense, a linear subspace of those linear series associated to a divisor. I want to show that the construction can be reversed. So the idea now, if I start with D, a divisor, well, I can define something that's very close to that, but that's just the vector space associated to that. I will call it LD. So that's a set of functions such that D plus divisor of F is positive. Okay, so by convention, I will add theta to this. I will add zero by convention. The other way is to you discard this and you say that the divisor of zero is infinity, so D plus infinity is positive, but that's a good way. So it's easy to see that it's a vector space and that actually this this is what I call the linear series, is just the projective space associated to that. This is true if X is projective. You need to know what are the functions that are regular to on the whole variety, if they are constants. So that's for X projective. From now on, I will consider only X projective. So what if I take, F naught, Fn, a basis of Ld, then I can define the map, well, a good point because a priori it's not defined everywhere, but I can define this as a rational map. Well, to X, associate S0 of X, Fn of X. And of course, I extend it as much as I can. Well, what I claim is that those constructions are essentially reciprocal, so that's literally taken is false, but if you add something, it's true. first here, there is a choice of bases. So of course, if I change bases, then I have to apply a linear automorphism here. So I can only recover this map up to linear automorphism here. There is another glitch. It's well, it could be that all these functions have the same component in their divisor, so you have to remove that. But with those two precautions, then there is essentially a bijective correspondence between those two things. So to a divisor, you can associate the rational map, and to a map, you can add a system of divisor, and to a map, you can associate a system of divisors. That's the basic idea. Now, this construction can help us in constructing heights in the following sense. So, to construct heights, the first thing is, okay, I will start with the first step. I will assume that my divisor or line bubble, I will speak only later of line bubble, to explain how this can be formulated as line bubble. Let's say, first, a D is a pullback of a fiber plane for some maps, for some so if I write this, I mean really a morphism. Everywhere defined. Then I will define the height with respect to D of T. By definition, that will be the height on Pn of phi. It is not at all obvious that it's well defined, and in fact it's not well defined, but we will show it's well defined up to bounded function. That is, what if I write D as the pullback by some other morphism of a hyperplane? The claim is that the two functions you get here are equal up to a bounded function. So this is modulo bounded function. this little tree is well defined. The second step is well, it will look silly if D is equal to phi 1. Well, it's the difference of two such divisors. So I should write H2. Then I will define HB of P as well, the height with respect to, well, let's put it that way. The height with respect to phi 1 P minus the height with respect to phi 2 P. Again, modulo bounded. Now I make two claims. First is that you can always write a divisor like this. So that's elementary algebraic geometry. The second, which is more tricky, is that again this is a proper definition. That is, if I take two representation of a divisor like this, and I compute those functions, they will be equal up to a bounded function. Okay, so I have to show that, but before doing that, I'll state the main theorem about those heights, because that it's a good notion. That it's a notion that enables to translate geometric facts into arithmetic facts. I will just state the theorem, and then we'll prove. The main point is to prove that it is well defined. Once you know it's well defined, that the theorem follows almost a large part of the theorem follows. functorial homomorphism. That's a short way to say all of that. You notice also that perhaps this construction looks weird, but if you want maps that satisfy those nice properties, it's clear that if it exists, you can construct it like this. Once you know, all you have to know that T can be written as the difference of two such devices. Then you use this property and this property, and you know that the thing has to be that. Sorry, you use this one, and this one. So it's not, perhaps it looks artificial, but it's not that artificial. So this argument shows you that those four properties entirely characterize this height. So this is enough. I will write it enough. Characterize. Right. There are two more properties which are interesting and useful. OCTDG, that's the one that's really most useful. If D is effective, then the height is positive outside D. So that you can write so H X D very high. Then for all points not on D, you have that the height of D greater than some constant. But if you want up to a choice of the function, the height is positive, but outside the device, it can be very false on the device itself. So of course you can replace, if I call BD the base locus. That's the intersection of all the devices D prime, for D prime linearly equivalent to D and positive. It's of course also true for all D, because this intersection is actually finite, it's a Noetherian property. And so you write the finitely many inequalities, and you take the minimum of the constant, and you get that. But the main statement is this one. There is a last property that is interesting. Perhaps I will write it here. So for the six, I will assume that X is smooth. But to be honest, I don't know if it's true or when it's not smooth. The point is, if you have D, which is algebraically equivalent to zero, so algebraically equivalent to zero means you can deform the divisor to zero, but topologically not linearly. Or you can even say numerically equivalent to zero if you know what that is. And if, let's call it A is ample, then the height of the height with respect to D is much smaller, that is, it's smaller than the square root of the height of A. Without the smoothness hypothesis, you can show something much weaker, but that still says that it's you could say that it's a little O of without the smoothness hypothesis, you can show that this is a little old, but of course that's much stronger. Of course, in this statement you have two things to say that you made a choice that the height is less than, say, greater than one.
I'm sorry, what is this?
Sorry, something unclear?
What is A? What is A?
A is an upward divisor. Oh, attends, okay.
So если несколько раз с собой сложишь, у тебя получится вложение в такие пространства.
Let me define quickly what is ample algebraically and numerically equivalent, and then I will start with general things on divisors, but that's these are the important definition. What is a very ample divisor? So I should say also, in those statements you should understand divisor to mean Cartier divisors. So of course if the variety is not too nasty, it's the same as their divisors, but all those statements are for Cartier divisors. So very ample divisor, well, D is the fallback of a hyperplan section for some phi, which is an embedding. It means if I construct a map associated with this D, it will give me an embedding. That's what it means. Or conversely, it's a hyperplan section. So that's very ample. It's a definition, not a property. And ample means some multiple is very ample. I T the map
means there's an algebraic deformation that goes from this divisor to this one. Well, that generates an equivalence relation. That's the so-called algebraic deformation. And actually makes sense, the same makes sense for algebraic cycles. So that's algebraically the equivalent. Numerical equivalence will say that T1 numerically equivalent to T2. That means that the intersection with any curve, that gives a number. So you need to define, of course, intersection of a curve with a divisor, which is easier than the general intersection theory. That it's always equal to C T2. So that's the definition of numerical equivalence. So there's something that's relatively easy, is that D1 linearly equivalent to D2 implies D1 is algebraically equivalent to D2, and it implies that D1 is numerically equivalent to D2. That's the so-called invariance by deformation of intersection. So it's not a trivial thing, but it's well known. And it's almost the reciprocal is almost true for divisors, not for higher codimensional cycles. Is that if two divisors are numerically equivalent, then some multiples are algebraically equivalent. That is, they exist an M such that MD1 is algebraically equivalent to MD2. Okay, I won't use actually this, but I suppose so that it remains clear. And I mentioned this property, though we won't really use it because it comes from abelian variety, and we'll see it very clearly on abelian varieties. On abelian varieties, if D is algebraically equivalent to zero, this function is a linear function, and this one is quadratic, so that's why we get square root. Now, actually, the main part of the proof is proving that the construction that I indicated is a true construction, that it gives a well-defined object. So the main point is to show that, well, I start with any divisor D. Then I do two things. I write it, well, I can write it, well, that I have not proved it, that's not difficult. Phi 1, H1 minus of H2. So with, well, Phi
condition that would be the height of phi 1 minus the height of phi 2 p, where okay, this little h, this is the height defined on Pn and Pn. And to the point, if I can write this as, say, psi 1 of minus psi 2, and I define the second height function as height of c 1 minus the height. What I really need to show is that the difference of those two functions is bounded. Okay. So actually, so I will give names to those devices. Let's say I will call this one D1. One D2, and this one say delta 1 and delta 2. Perhaps I should use a Russian meter. Okay. So we have, of course, the radiation D1 plus delta 2 is delta 1 plus D2. So I will look at the following map. I can set the map from, I can take two maps from X. The first map will be defined using phi 1 and psi 2. So that goes to p, well, never mind, some p n cross m. Of course, I should put a dash here, but never mind. And I have the other map, which will be phi, say phi 2 and psi 1, so m cross pn. And I use the Segre map, so here I get a big T, say m1, the dimension don't matter, this is just Segre. Now you notice that if I look at this map, so the height with the height of the image of this point will be the height with phi 2 plus the height of psi 1. And the other one will be the height of phi 1 plus the height of c 2. So actually, what we want to show is that the image by these two maps, they have roughly the same height. So to do that, the first thing is to see that I should keep the map. If I look at this map as prime composed with phi 2 1. Oh, so this gives a map from x to pm. So if I look at the pullback of a height of n, I call it h. Okay, even if h has been already used, it's just a hyperplane in the corresponding projective space. This is, well, not exactly equal to delta 2, but it's linearly equivalent to delta 1 missing are that I need to explain me what is the pullback of a hyperplane on this product. After that it will be clear. And the corresponding thing is also true. If I do the corresponding computation with the other map, then I get d1 plus delta 2. So what I get is that this is linearly equivalent to S composed with I1 psi 2. That's the first step. So of another hyperplane, because the hyperplane is in another projective space. Now, this means that if I take the map associated with the linear system delta 1 plus d2. But this is the map that if I use it, I get all the, this is all the devices that are linearly equivalent to this one. So if I do that, I get another map to some big projective space. So this is the map associated to the linear system d1 plus delta 2. Now what I say if I look at the construction is that, that the linear system associated to this map has to be a sublinear system of this one. And same thing, this one, this map has to be a sublinear system. So what it means is that this map, here you have some linear projection, and if you understand it's trivial or otherwise it's obscure, but okay. So this map is given by all devices linearly equivalent to this one. Now this one, when you pull back a hyperplane, you get one of those devices. So when you make them move, you get a subfamily, a linear subfamily inside this. So that means, in some sense, that you have a vector space here, and you have a sub-vector space, and it's given by that. Now, a linear projection, of course, is not defined everywhere. It's defined outside a linear subspace. But and that's the main point of the proof. You know that this is a morphism because those are morphisms. And therefore, the image of X here doesn't meet the linear subspace where it's not defined. Because otherwise, the composite wouldn't be a morphism. So now I use what I call the main properties of heights on projective space. If you remember, is that the height composed with the linear projection is equal to the height up to a bounded function. So on X. Such that X doesn't meet the linear subspace on which phi is not defined doesn't meet X. Under that condition, the linear projection doesn't change the height, or change it only with a bounded function. So that was something that I showed, that was the proposition using the Neumstern Satz, if you remember. It was actually only a corollary. I showed that it was true for maps defined by polynomials of any degree. And for degree 1, normally there would be a d here, but here it equals to 1. So if you put everything together, we can now write the following, that the height of this phi b1 plus delta 2 of p, so the height here, so is the height of this map applied to the point pi of that, so is equal to the height of S of, well, I will actually write it, S composed with phi 1 plus 2 of P plus 4 1. This is because this point is exactly pi of this point. Perhaps phi 1, I should call them phi 1. By 2, so this is via by 1. Now, I recall that the height of Segre is just the sum of the two heights, so this is, so that was very elementary, that's phi 1 of p plus the height of p plus 0 of 1. Now, of course, I can switch. I use this equality of the divisor, and I do exactly the same downstairs. And I get that this is also the height of phi 2 of p plus the height of c 1 of p. Now, there's one thing that I skipped, it's not the most difficult part, is that why is this equality? That's a very simple one. There's many ways to see this. So first of all, of course, showing the equality of those two things is exactly the same as showing those two equal two bounded functions. The point is, what is if I have the Segre map? I don't write the number, it doesn't matter. What is the fallback of a hyperplane? The only thing that's important is the class of it. Well, claim that it's, I should write Pn. So I have the map, well, there's lots of p's, but on Pn and on Pn. So I claim that it's one, I can pull back a hyperplane here. And I can pull back the hyperplane here. So actually, if I write it as an equality of divisor, it's not necessarily true, but it's linearly equivalent to this. And if I choose properly, H is an equality, of course. That's a very simple. The map is, well, to the xi and yj, you map to the point with coordinates xi, yj. So call those coordinates zij. Well, if I choose h naught equals, well, z, say z 0, 0 equals 0, this coordinate is the one of the product. Well, what is the fallback of H? Well, it's source point here such that x naught y naught is equal to 0. So So you get first the divisor xy, where x naught is equal to 0, plus the divisor of the xy, such that y naught is equal to 0. So this one is actually sort of the pullback of a divisor down there. And this one is actually the pullback of a divisor down there. It's a very simple computation. But of course, I used it implicitly to write it. And by the way, that's another example where you can put it in the Picard group, the Picard group of EN. And it is the sum of those two Picard groups, so it's Z2. In other words, so any divisor on this is defined by a bihomogeneous polynomial of degree D1, D2. That's the same. And of course, you can generalize that to several copies. That's nice. That gives us at least the properties for the main properties for height. So, from the construction, you can see that the first four properties are absolutely formal. Once you know that it's well defined, it's really absolutely formal. You use again the Segre map, and let's show, for example, I did it as an exercise. You use the same arguments and it's formal, it's easier. Obviously, if I add the D, which is positive, It's true, of course. But what's more interesting is that it's included in 91. So what this means is that if I look at the map, now I look at those two maps, the first one corresponds to this linear vector space, and the other one to this one. So you go from one to the other by linear projection. So you have linear projection here. Outside D. And that's why you get the correct inequality, but only outside D. It's easy to give maybe a image like this. So the argument really requires to be outside D. But you could ask, well, what? Perhaps another argument will give positivity even on D. But that's not true. Let's see, for example, if I take, I blow up if I blow up a point, so I have an exceptional divisor here, which is just this image of Q. So the statement is that HQP is positive. Well, I write positive for greater than some constant. It's the same after some choice for P not in P. Okay. Now the point is that satisfied. But if I take e prime, linearly equivalent to e, well, you know that the self intersection is minus one. So if I restrict this to e, what I get is the divisor, which is linearly equivalent to minus the point on p1. So actually, this tells you that the height on e is the same as the height as minus the height on p1. It tells you that on e, if I identify I with one, h e is minus the height of p1. So of course it gets very negative. So really, you can't go away with if you have an effective divisor, the height is positive, okay, but outside the divisor. If you can move the divisor, then you're okay, but if you can, of course, this is an example of a divisor that cannot move remaining positively. If it could, the height would be positive. Okay, so this machinery is exactly what is needed. Now we need to know, of course, more on divisors, on varieties. So next time I will do divisors on curves and abelian varieties. So on curves, it's essentially I will state the Riemann-Rolle theorem, as I suppose you've already seen it, on curves. Well, anyway, the statement is easy to understand, and the statement that says that on the curve, the dimension, if I call the L D, the dimension of L D, that you can compute minus L K minus D, is the degree of D minus D plus 1. This is okay. So I will just recall how to use this to get things on curves. Sorry, maybe I pronounced it as the Riemann Rolle. Riemann Rolle. Okay. So I will use it to explain, well, to describe the so that I will take for granted. I will recall what is a canonical divisor. So that's interesting if you've never seen it. Then the statement is not difficult to understand. It's not easy to prove, but it gives a definition of the genus. That's nice. And so I will show that it coincides with other definition of the genus. And I will show how to. I will explain how with this you can prove two things. You can prove this for an elliptic curve, this exact sequence, and also with this you can prove that the group law I defined on the cubic is associative without effort, without, because otherwise it's a bit painful.
It's easy.
Okay. And also it gives gives a nice picture, because what is not at all, it's not at all obvious that E, say the curve of genus 1, has a group law. Once you show this, this is a group. It's the kernel of a group homomorphism, so it's a group. And the other thing, it's not at all obvious that the kernel of this group is an algebraic object, that it's in the sense of algebraic geometry, that it's an algebraic variety, and it shows both at the same time. And when we look now one of the deepest fact is that actually this is again an algebraic variety, actually an abelian variety of dimension g. So this will be let's say what an abelian variety of dimension g. Of course, if the genus is 1, this is the same as the curve. If the genus is 0, this is 0. That's why T1 is so easy. But for curves of genus 2 or higher, you get abelian varieties of higher dimension. And this was actually the starting point of why I study abelian varieties. So this is called the Jacobian variety of the curve.